When I was growing up, grew up in a great church, by the way. When I was growing up, our particular church had a tradition, and the tradition when it came to communion was this. We, not sometimes, but we always did it on the first Sunday of the month. And, you know, the Lord doesn't tell us anywhere in Scripture how often to do it. He just says as often as you do this. Now, that's up to the local church to figure out how often to do it. Some traditions do it every Sunday, some once a month, some once a quarter. But our church did it once a month, first Sunday of the month, not second Sunday, third Sunday, fourth Sunday, first Sunday of the month. And perhaps it was my my naivete, my immaturity, and a lot of other things, but it seemed to me that often the communion service was kind of like an addendum on the end of a service. It was just kind of tacked on, you know, 5 minutes extra. Again, maybe it didn't seem that way to everybody else, but it seemed that way to me sometimes. Again, I wasn't the most mature person in the congregation, I'm sure, but I remember getting close to the end of the service thinking, oh, let's go, let's go, let's go, and the pastor would announce, and now we're going to do communion. Oh, no, not communion. But it seemed like it was just kind of an add-on sometimes. I guess one statement I'll make for you, and then we'll talk about this a little bit more, would be in the church, if we're not careful, it's probably true not just in the church, but in life in general, if we're not careful, we take essential things and make them extraneous. They're kind of like become peripheral. And we take peripheral things and they can sometimes become focal. And that happens sometimes when it comes to communion. It becomes their extraneous kind of peripheral thing. We just kind of tack it on here and 5 minutes there. And some things that are very peripheral, not even that important, can become essential in church. So I'm going to ask a question, then we're going to dive into God's Word in just a second. And here's the question. What two truths, when it comes to communion and the Lord's Supper, what two truths should we remind ourselves of frequently? Two truths, or maybe even two concepts, two words. Try to answer that idea or that question this morning. If you would, take your Bible, go to Luke's Gospel, Luke 22. We're going to look at a few verses there. We're going to skip over to Mark's Gospel in just a few minutes, but we'll begin in Luke. And as we go there, as you're turning, maybe a couple of ideas, two words, two concepts, and we'll flesh these out. The two words are these, remember, or in remembrance, and second word is to anticipate. So in remembrance and in anticipation. The word remember means to bring to mind, to think of, to be careful not to forget. Something you have to deliberately do. Bring something to mind. Say, I'm not going to forget that. I'm going to ponder this. To anticipate is to expect, to look forward to. So before we dive into those four verses, a couple more questions. Have you ever noticed how easy it is to forget things that once dominated your thinking? I'm going to test this theory out a little bit. I'm going to call out some dates, all right? So here we go. December 7, 1941. That's good. Okay. December 7, 41. November 22nd, 1963. Well, you're doing good. April 4, 1968. MLK's assassination. You're still doing pretty good. January 28, 1986. Space Shuttle Challenger blew up. Y'all did better than I thought you would. Give yourselves an A. If you enroll at CCBS, I'll give you an A. But you have to admit, even though you did quite well on the quiz, those things that were central to us can, after a while, become just kind of like afterthought. In fact, if you don't believe this, just go up to somebody in the next few weeks and just say, or if you wait till November the 22nd and just say to somebody without setting them up, just say, do you know what happened today in history? And they're like, no. We don't usually think about JFK's assassination on the 22nd of November like we did 45, 50 years ago. I actually happened to be alive and lived in Dallas, the Dallas area when that happened, but I was four, and so when you're four, you know, it doesn't mean anything to you. Things that were once essential now become kind of peripheral. And it's easy to let secondary, tertiary things become central. For example, Christmas we say it's the birth of Christ. Now, we understand, we don't know the exact date that when Jesus was born. We don't know if it was December 25th, but that's the date we've picked and we celebrate it for all these centuries later. Have you noticed how even in solid evangelical homes that often becomes just kind of like a 5 or 10 minute nod, and then it becomes all about the presents and the food? Would you at least agree to that? Okay. And Easter, of course, we know what that is, but increasingly it can become, you know, the time to get a new outfit, and we get an Easter basket and lots of chocolate bunny rabbits and all the stuff that goes with Easter. It shouldn't be that way, but that's kind of what happens. Well, let's go back to the Bible in Luke chapter 22. These are not going to be new words to any of you, I'm sure. This is the night of Jesus' arrest. And he says this in verse 17 of Luke 22. And when he had taken a cup and given thanks, he said, "This, take this and share it among yourselves. For I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine from now on till the kingdom of God comes." When he had taken some bread, given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And the same way he took the cup after they had eaten, saying, "This cup is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood." Now we're going to come back in just a minute. But in this whole concept of in remembrance, again, I grew up in a church a long way from here, but I remember in our particular church we had a rather nice big communion table, and carved in the front of that in the wood was "in remembrance of me." Those words were carved across the front. And so every Sunday you'd show up and you'd see that phrase, even if we didn't have communion that Sunday, "in remembrance of me." It's a great biblical concept. Jesus mentions it right here. So in remembrance. When we celebrate communion together, we ought to be remembering something. Remember, to remember means to bring to mind, to be careful not to forget. I'm going to suggest to you two things that ought to come to mind, or we ought to remember when we do this thing called communion. First is this: we ought to be reminded, we ought to remember the price that was paid for our deliverance. If you're the kind that writes in your Bible, or if you're not, just at least notice this. Look in verse 19 of the passage we just read. Jesus says about the middle of the verse, "This is my body which is given for you." This isn't new. You've heard this before, but the bread is a symbol of Jesus' body. But that phrase, "This is my body which was given for you," was Jesus' death, his life and then his death, his body which was given to purchase the price of, to pay the price of our redemption. Next verse, the last phrase, he says, "This is the cup which is poured out, this cup which is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood." New covenant in my blood. So his body was given, his blood was shed. A verse all of you could quote probably, John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son." That's the price that it took for me to have life, and you, if you've trusted in Jesus, for you to have life, was Jesus' body. I'm reminded, we're not going to go there. First Peter, who was one of Jesus' disciples and had observed the crucifixion and so forth, but Peter says this in chapter 1 of his first epistle. This is a Corver paraphrase, but it's close to this. He says, we weren't redeemed with perishable things like gold and silver and precious stones, because that's going to pass away. And it's really not valuable at all as compared to, he says, we were redeemed with the precious blood of Jesus. That's the price of redemption, Jesus' blood. A price that no one else could pay, he paid. When I think about this high price paid, I think of my childhood. My parents, who I saw 2 weeks ago in Oklahoma, have been married for 65 years. They were both born and raised in Northwest Iowa. And in Northwest Iowa, back in the late 40s, early 50s, when they were coming up, it was customary for the bride-to-be to give her husband an engagement ring, too. The guy would give the girl an engagement ring. Most of us are familiar with that, yes? The ladies invented that custom, by the way. You can laugh, okay? But in that culture, the guys gave the girls gave the guys an engagement ring, too. I've never heard of this anywhere else, but my parents told me that was true in that part of Iowa, at least in the Dutch community they grew up in. And so I'm a little boy, and my mom's telling me this story. So my mom and dad were born in 32 and 34, so they married in 51, if you're pretty good in math, when they were 17 and 19. So my mom, to make money for my dad's engagement ring, babysat. Now, back when she was babysitting, babysitting wasn't just babysitting. It was a lot more than that, because they had cloth diapers and you had to rinse those out and put them in the... And when the baby actually went down for a nap, you were expected to iron clothes and do all the things that the mother or the wife of the house wanted you to do when she was gone for several hours. Oh, and the sum for such work was 25 cents an hour. 25 cents an hour. Anyway, so back to the story. My dad has this incredible engagement ring he used to wear when I was a kid. Actually, still wears it now. It's probably, I don't know, 14 karat gold, and it's got about a carat and a half ruby in the middle, and then two little diamonds on either side. And I remember thinking when I was a kid, man, that is the coolest ring. And honestly, if you told me now, hey, your mom and dad are both gone out of their entire estate, what would you like? That'd be the one thing I'd ask if I could have that. I'm the youngest of three boys, so I figure I'm third in line. My two brothers may want it more than me. And because I'm younger, I figure they deserve it. But at 25 cents an hour, that ring cost my mom 600 hours of labor. That's like 15 weeks of full-time work to get that ring from my dad. I think that's just a little image of what we ought to think of when we think about communion. The incredible price that our Savior paid so we could have life. It wasn't 600 hours of this. No, it was His own life and His blood that He shed so we could have life. So when we celebrate together, and we should, but when we remember, we ought to remember that nothing and no one could have done what Jesus did. Bill Gates couldn't have stroked a check to give you life eternal. Bill Gates and Warren Buffett put together couldn't stroke that check. Only Jesus could give His blood and be accepted by the Father. Here's another thing I think that when we remember, that we ought to be reminded of this, that it's a picture of true greatness, what Jesus did. You say, well, how do you get that from this passage? Well, humor me just a minute. You've heard me talk, preach before, and I'm fond of saying this, that context is really important. Well, we don't have time to read, but just look in verse 24. We can read that. Right after what we just read, verse 24 of Luke 22. And there arose also a dispute amongst them as to which one of them was to be regarded as the greatest. Okay? So Jesus just told them during this meal, and the meal wasn't, by the way, just a communion. It was a full-blown meal. And interspersed in there was what we'd call communion. And in the course of this whole evening together, Jesus tells them the things he does, and they get into an argument. Now, Judas has already left, but the other 11 are there. And the argument was something like this: I'm number one, and when Jesus is king, I'll be number one. And everybody else, no, you're not going to be number one. You might be number two, but we already know I'm number one. And this whole argument breaks out. But right before this all happened, in John 13, Jesus, when they were arguing over greatness, just nonchalantly goes to the side, not calling attention to himself, and clear, excuse me, man, I'm about to teach you a lesson. Takes off his outer garment, put a towel, we'd call it an apron, around his waist, and knelt, and by the first disciple, we don't know who was first, he said, excuse me, and starts washing his feet. See, think about that. By the way, Peter really was dead on when he said this. He's just like we would have been had we been there. Lord, you're not washing my feet. Can you imagine how humiliating it would be for the King of the universe, the Creator of all things, and your Redeemer, to come up to you this morning and say, excuse me, take your socks and shoes off, I'm washing your feet, and kneel down. So when we remember, we ought to remember the great price paid, absolutely. We also remember what true greatness really is. It's when you're a servant. Now, we're not going to go there, but Mark 10:45, Most Bible scholars think Mark 10:45 is the theme verse for the book of Mark. And it goes something like this. The Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and give his life a ransom for many. That's the point. Jesus' coming was to serve. So what do we remember? We've got to remember at least two things. The high price paid for your redemption and mine. And what true greatness really is. See, here's how we measure true greatness. We measure it by position. You know, if I get this position and they have to call me boss, man, I've arrived. We measure it by position. We measure it by portfolio. Man, I got this really killer big portfolio. I got lots of stuff in my 401k. And how many people bow down to us and take orders from us, and how much do our peers recognize us? That doesn't matter at all. Here's the creator of the universe, bends a knee, washes feet, and a few hours later goes to Calvary's cross. That'll be a reminder of his greatness and what true greatness really is. Well, we don't just remember. I think in remembering we get a good bit of the story, absolutely. And I'm not disparaging at all the communion tables that say, do this in remembrance of me. That's a great concept the Bible tells us we should remember. We look back to what Jesus did. But we ought to also look forward. It's hinted at a little bit. Look in verse 18, and then we'll go over to Mark's gospel. Verse 18, Jesus said this, "For I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine from now on till the kingdom of God comes." Okay, so he's looking forward to some other time, this thing called the kingdom of God. If you would, go to Mark chapter 14. Mark 14, in verses 22 to 25. While they were eating, he took some bread, and after a blessing, he broke it and gave it to them and said, "Take this, this is my body." And when he had taken a cup and given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank from it. And he said to them, "This is the blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I say, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." You see this idea, though the word isn't used in anticipate. Do you see the idea of anticipation, looking to the future? This is a yes. Okay. So when is, you can talk back in my sermon, so when is Jesus going to, for the next time in history, this is over 2,000 years ago when he said this, or almost 2,000 years ago, when is the next time Jesus is going to consume anything that's a product of grapes? When he's the king. When the kingdom happens. Yes? You good with that? I'm going to teach a whole class on eschatology and what I think of eschatology, but it's sometime in the future. And so we look back, we absolutely should, we look back to what Jesus did. He paid this price and he models for us true greatness. But while we look back, we ought to also look forward. We anticipate. In the Passover Seder, they would consume four cups at four different times. The fourth one pointed to the time when Jesus would be Messiah, and he would rule over his people. Probably that's the one Jesus is talking about. This is expectation, looking forward to when I rule and reign. Now, we're not going to go there, but here's the thought. When we anticipate, it brings hope. When we anticipate where we're going, it should bring hope. Let me just give you a couple of ideas if you're the kind that writes down notes. Isaiah chapter 2, verses 2 to 4. I'll just give you some scripture references and I'll kind of summarize them together. Isaiah 2, 2 to 4. Isaiah 9, 2 to 7. And Isaiah 11, 2 through 9. Those are three passages in Isaiah 2, 9, and 11. And here's, in part, what they tell us. That Jesus is going to be king someday, and when Jesus is king, he rules over everything, and there will be no end to the increase of his government. Okay? So just think about that. We're going to talk about a little bit why this ought to bring hope. How long is Jesus going to be king? Forever. Now, I don't want to get political on you, but this ought to give you a lot of hope. Did you get as exhausted as I did the last political cycle? Yes? And you got tired of all the ads? Yes? Okay, here's a piece that gets a far better than what I'm about to say, but Jesus is not going to post any ads, and he's not looking for votes, and he's never coming up for re-election. He's going to reign forever and ever and ever. So, and it's not just that he doesn't come up for re-election. It says this, that righteousness will be the belt around his waist. In other words, when you have a king who never comes up for re-election and he's a perfect king, this is really good. Perfect. Oh, and health. We get glorified bodies out of this deal. I thought I'd at least heard an amen from somebody over 60 at this point. We get a brand new body. Right now, my wife Marcia's oldest sister's husband, so my brother-in-law, his name happens to be Bill also, he's struggling with cancer. Unless the Lord intervenes, he's probably not long for this world. I've got a neighbor across the street. I've tried to share the gospel with them. The wife is not a believer, and talked to their daughter yesterday. She's basically dying. She might not make it through today. You realize when Jesus is king, there will be no more sickness, period. Wow. So, great government. Nobody gets sick anymore. Oh, and as Paul said in Romans 7, the things I know I should do, I don't do. Things I know I shouldn't do, I end up doing them. Wretched man that I am. Because listen, even if it was great government and if you never got sick again, you still got a major problem. And that's your flesh. Y'all really ought to do this at this point. Our number one problem isn't somebody else. Our number one problem is us. And you're going to get a brand new nature. So forever and ever, you got a perfect king who rules in perfect righteousness. Nobody ever gets sick. And you don't have a problem with a sin nature. Wow.
Amen, brother.
Oh, and there's this grand reunion coming too. 1 Thessalonians 4:13-18 says this, and the dead in Christ shall rise first, and then we who are alive and remain will be caught up to be with him in the air.
Hallelujah.
If you've known anybody in your entire lifetime who loved Jesus and believed his gospel and has preceded you in death, it could be a wonderful reunion that time. And if you're like me and you love to study some of the greats of Scripture, can you imagine what it would be like to just sit down with, pick your favorite? Joseph, what was it like to, and Abraham, what was it like when you did this? Noah, what was it like when you built that ark and just kept hammering and hammering? What was it like, you know? And Paul, what was it like when you went over here? Just conversations. Wow. It ought to give us a great deal of hope. That's where we're going. Some of you know the name J.R.R. Tolkien, right? Lord of the Rings. I got to put my glasses back on for this. Tolkien was accused of being an escapist, of being an escapist. That his style of writing would just promoted this escapism, where people who'd read his stuff would just kind of escape reality, and you know, kind of like a little kid who has an imaginary friend, and it wasn't healthy and so forth. So he just created escapism sort of life, and it wasn't the real deal. One of the books that I read some time back talked about that. I thought it was a great quote. J.R.R. Tolkien was often accused of writing escapist literature, of conjuring up a world that indulged the human longing to slip the boredom and burden of living from our 9-to-5, hand-to-mouth, this-and-that lives. His answer was that there are two kinds of escape. The first is the escape of one who's running away from life, who can't endure its disappointments and responsibilities. It's the painter Paul Gauguin who abandoned his wife and children to try to capture some earthly paradise in Tahiti. Or Jean-Jacques Rousseau who kept dumping his illegitimate children in orphanages so he could pursue his ambitions to write about the perfection of child-rearing. I'm not kidding, I'm not making this up. This form of escape is hypocritical and pathetic. But then Tolkien added this, but there's a second form of escape. It is the escape of the prisoner of war who seeks to break out of the grim, muddy compound with its scowling guards, its snarling dogs, its shockingly dreadful threats, and numbingly dull routines, its guns and fleas and gruel. All he wants, and it is a huge want, able to carry him when nothing else can, is to go home. This form of escape keeps us human. Tolkien said that he was writing about the second kind of escapism, not the first. Then the author of the book says this: "If heavenly-mindedness is a form of escapism, it is of the second kind, a remembrance and an expectancy, a groaning for home, a longing that sustains us no matter how dark it gets. Heavenly-mindedness is sanity. It is the best regimen for keeping our hearts whole, our minds clear. It allows us to enjoy earth's pleasures without debauchery. It allows us to endure life's agonies without despair. It allows us to see things from the widest possible perspective and in the truest possible proportions. If anything can give us a true scale of values, one that enables us to sort out the disposable from the precious, the trinkets from the treasures, the surface from the substance, heavenly mindedness can." And I would suggest to you, anticipating the King can do that for you. We don't just look back, we look forward. I might add this: when we look forward, it changes the way we live. It gives us motivation to live each day well. We're not going to go there, but one of the verses that I committed to memory years ago, and it was important enough to me that I encourage each of my three children to commit to memory, is 1 John 2:28. The writer, John the Apostle, says this: "Now, little children, abide in him, so that when he appears, we may have confidence and not shrink away from him in shame at his coming." When we anticipate the King coming back, it changes the way you live today. We ought to look back, absolutely. But we just as absolutely ought to look forward. So when we have communion in just a few minutes, let's look back to the price he paid. Let's look forward, because our King's coming back, and it may be soon. Let me close this in prayer. Father, we're grateful that we can be here. Thank you for the wisdom of your word. If we're not careful, Lord, we forget. We push to the side, to the deep recesses of our minds, what's really important. The car we drove today, the score of last night's game are really not that important. The life we have in you because of what Jesus did for us is essential. It's core to who we are. Help us to remember that. At the same time, Lord, help us to anticipate. Anticipate a call from you, a reunion with you and those who've preceded us, and a never-ending kingdom. Help us to live heavenly-minded and then live a life that pleases you today. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.